Hi, Tony. How's it going?
Good morning, Ron. It's going well. How about you? How are the interviews been this morning?
Very well, thanks. Yeah, it's going good.
Well, terrific. I can't wait to get started, so let's do that right now. Let's talk a little bit about the next season of Loudermilk. First of all, it's a terrifically funny and yet dark comedy series, isn't it?
Yes. Oh, definitely. And that, you know, the darkness of it is, I think, a lot of what makes it funny. There's something about subjects that are taboo, either taboo to talk about at all, like substance abuse, and or you can talk about them, but you can't try to do so in a humorous way. It's like trying to not laugh in church. It just makes it even funnier somehow.
Well, I think the character himself has got so many layers to him. I mean, he's obviously a deeply flawed individual, but that's what makes him so interesting. I bet it's interesting as an actor to play someone like this, too.
Yeah, you know, I feel like the rule on TV is characters are always trying to embrace their noble aspects and always trying to, try and fix their shortcomings. Loudermilk embraces all of his flaws. There's something about him that he wouldn't be any other way. He couldn't be any other way. You know, he doesn't have a filter. He just believes in speaking the truth as it occurs to him at the time, even when, you know, other people don't want to hear it or aren't even interested. He somehow, everything aggravates him, and he's got to tell you that.
And the fact is that, you know, going into the next season of this, you're allowed to explore this character a little bit more. What's new in the new season?
Last season, we kind of blew him up a little bit. You know, he lost a roommate. He lost his best friend, sponsor. He lost his ex-wife again. And he lost his group. So he's got to try to put that together again, or the pieces of it that he wants to put together again. He's got to try and figure a way to do that and decide where he's going to go from here. This season we really, like, he's going to attack some things that are difficult for him. He's going to try to take up writing again. There's some family issues that, you know, he's got to get sort of in there and roll up his sleeves with the family issues. We get to see him squirm, which it's a lot of fun to watch Loudermilk squirm.
Now, you're one of the busiest actors in Hollywood, it seems. I mean, Loudermilk, of course, but A Million Simple Things, A Million Little Things. That series is getting a lot of critical acclaim. You've been an actor forever, doing motion pictures, television, I'm assuming the stage as well. Television has really changed, hasn't it? I mean, with DirecTV and Hulu, and I mean, you're allowed to be a little freer on TV now.
Absolutely. We're not chained to standards and practices, and we're not. There's more than three channels, so you don't have to go get 50 million people to watch your show to be a success. You can find a niche. A little niche and go that way, you know. It's kind of a golden age for television. It reminds me, I feel like when I first started out back in the early 90s, it was a golden age for independent film, where all these sort of scrappy young, you know, companies and people were making movies outside of the system. And I feel like that's happening now in TV. There's you know, they're not necessarily scrappy small companies, but they're people who have not been part of the entertainment world, who were just rolling up their sleeves and going, well, let's try this. And it's a little bit of the Wild West, but it makes it really new and fresh. And I think there's a lot of great stuff that comes out of it.
Yeah, and I also like the idea of being able to latch on to a TV series like Loudermilk and be able to binge watch it, to be able to you know, sit and get to know those characters in an afternoon.
Well,
it used to take us weeks and weeks and weeks.
That's something that Pete said from the very first go. When we did season one, we had 10 episodes written before we started, and we shot them all together. So we shot it like a big long movie, and that's kind of unheard of in the TV world. Usually you get to read the first, you know, the pilot, the first episode, and when you start, you have no idea where it's going or what's going to happen. You just have to sort of trust that as they write it, you're going to go, oh, we're doing okay. You know, you're sort of one step behind it always. But I think part of the reason we can do that is that it gives people have the freedom now that they can watch it as a movie. You can watch the whole first season as a 5-hour movie if you're up to that, you know, or you can watch it as a traditional half hour show with a beginning and a middle and an end. And it's fun to mix those two things.
Well, before I let you go, you know, again, I got to say the series is Loudermilk, DirecTV. Catch it, binge watch it, and enjoy it. It's a great series. Are you going to be at Sundance this year? You've got a couple of new movies coming out, and I don't know if they're going to be premiering at Sundance.
It's a good question. I don't know. I haven't heard anything about it yet, so I don't know if that means we're not going to Sundance, or if I haven't been invited yet, or if I haven't been paying attention and there's an email in my inbox that I haven't opened. Any of those could be true.
I'm so interested to see The Man Who Killed Hitler and Bigfoot.
On the title alone, you're right.
Just the title.
Just the title. How do you not sign on to that?
I know. It's one of those films I just now have to see. Anyway, I appreciate your time this morning, Ron. It's a pleasure, as always, to talk to you.
Thank you.
Loudermilk, a million little things. You can catch Ron everywhere. And like I said, enjoy Loudermilk. It's one of the real fun gems on TV. And thanks again for your time this morning.
Absolutely. Thank you.